Well, thank you very much indeed, Barry. It's a great pleasure and privilege to be here. I don't know whether I will fulfil the prejudice of those who can't do teach, those who can't teach do research, and those... I'm looking at Jane Robinson, help, in the audience, who was my mentor and founding... Is the loop microphone on? Because I know that some people are a wee bit hard of hearing. Is it?
That's better.
That's better, Jane, right. And those who can't teach do research, and those who can't research do become deans. So that was my fate, which I have to say... is no longer. I'm now a regular member of our faculty and very proud to be so. But it's great to also be amongst even those of who were my John Fletcher boss and colleagues, and colleagues from previous times as well. John was also a colleague at University of Nottingham, the foundational period of its own history in the School of Nursing, and Jane was the foundational professor of nursing there. John, of course, has connections with the university here at Worcester, still maintained those, I think. So, without any further ado on those preliminaries, I want to talk to you, as Barry has already indicated, about really the conditions under which it is actually possible to express compassion. There's a great pressure on nurses to be compassionate. It's written in like a genetic code into the chief nurse's strategy, compassion in practice. And sometimes one doesn't quite know whether it's a cri de coeur, a call to arms, or a stipulation. As I gather in the previous talk, we heard Charlie talking about the prescription almost for compassion that's expected from health professionals. You can't command compassion into being. Perhaps we can create the conditions under which it can be conjured and curated, but that is predicated on providing, I'm going to argue, an enabling environment in which practitioners can act with compassion. And that needs a resource base of time and space to work from within. So, I want to present some numbers, some data, really, to give a broader canvas across which I think we can think about this whole issue of compassion. And I'm going to draw from a major European study I've had the pleasure and privilege of contributing to and participating in and leading for the UK, and pay tribute to my collaborators from the US and other parts of Europe, and indeed from the UK. And this study was started life as an attempt, rather ambitiously, to look at workforce planning across Europe, and actually, rather than say what is the supply of nurses, how do we secure enough nurses to stock the service actually in a sustainable way, if we manage to plan a service, and we never think about quality as being an indicator that we will plan for, but let's say we can get to a position in which we have a notional sense of the relationship between nursing inputs and quality of care for patients, wouldn't the next logical step be to say, let's plan for a certain level of quality? If we want our patients to have this level of quality rather than that level of quality, how many more nurses do we need? Then that was really the proposition that we set out to explore in this study. And I can tell you how far we've got in that. So the course of the next few minutes, said she rapidly looking for, there's the clock, that's handy. I'm going to share some of the main findings of that study and what it tells us about the capacity to exercise condition in a resource pressurised service. So we've had lots of headlines in the nursing press about the compassion squeeze and challenges of quality of care in our system. There's no shortage of complaints about quality of care in the National Health Service. And of course, at the eye of the storm was the scandal of care surrounding Mid Staffordshire NHS Foundation Trust. How many of you have heard of the failures of care at Mid Staffordshire NHS? Everyone. So no one is ignorant of this. It's got full coverage. And that, of course, has been a cause celebre of quality failures, system failures. 2,000 pages worth of text, testimony, together have created an extraordinary evidence base of inadequacy, sadly, for patients and the surrounding community in Mid Staffordshire. Now, some of you, I know Peter Nolan, and who's a professor of mental health nursing and a fellow nurse historian here, and others will have a more refined and granular understanding of what this particular catastrophe of care has done for that community. How do you heal? How do you treat a community itself with compassion? And what were the circumstances? The if you like, prodromal, the circumstances that prevailed before this particular episode exploded in our living rooms through the television and on the front pages of our newspapers. There were conditions already, as I understand it, incubating in that geography that perhaps made it more susceptible to some of the forces that engulfed it in that particular very, very, very sad tragedy. So the first alert came, though, with excessive mortality rates reported through a series of different monitoring mechanisms. And yet a capacity within that organisation to explain away poor results in a multiplicity of different ways. And just before, during the break, Peter and Tom and I were discussing previous scandals of care in psychiatric hospitals and the very complex, tangled, corrupt, if you like, psychodynamics that can conspire in a very powerful way to occlude and cut off criticism and really dampen it down. But this is not an issue which has only been prevalent within the UK. There has been uproar and concern about conditions in nursing which have translated into concerns about the quality of care for patients in other parts of Europe, and particularly deterioration in staffing numbers, which has been a lightning rod for many of these changes. And that, of course, was one of the signal features of the catastrophe at Mid Staffordshire, an absolute massacring of the nursing workforce numbers, not solely nursing, but nursing is often a soft target for austerity cuts. So with the economic crisis and meltdown across different European economies, we see different outworkings of these effects and impacts on what I think a number of us would consider to be one of the most powerful barometers of an economy, not just perhaps the financial economy, but maybe even the moral economy of a country, which is actually nursing itself. It's a very sensitive barometer. And in an article for Nursing Standard, we, myself and colleagues, argued that one of the challenges facing European nursing was that we were confronting this perfect storm of a potential reduction in numbers, financial squeeze, and the translation of that into poorer outcomes for patients, but also for nurses. This was mainly a response to accusations that were being made in the press about nurses lacking in compassion, a critique of the professional behaviour of nurses themselves, which of course was something, a flashpoint from Mid-Staffordshire's report. Nurses were seen and represented, demonised in some cases as abandoning the ethic of care, and their stations, if you like, as being the stewards of patient welfare. So what we were using our evidence base to do was to provide a kind of, if you like, research-based rebuttal to some of those charges and say, of course those behaviours are unwarranted and unforgivable, but they have been the product of a certain set of conditions and that have conspired to produce that behaviour. This is not because suddenly these nurses have turned into some evil clan. And the study that we undertook in 12 European countries was really about looking at more broadly the response of the nursing profession in different health economies to the effects of economic austerity, and trying to set that debate on some greater platform of evidence. So rather than using an emotional response of moral outrage — moral outrage might be a very important stimulus to response, nevertheless, that alone is not going to cut the ice with policymakers and decision makers. So what we were really looking at was how these resources were being deployed, as I said, in a range of different countries. And that slide just shows that there are lots of countries, lots of hospitals, lots of nursing units, and thousands of millions of patient outcome observations, mainly mortality and comorbidities. So this is actually the largest study, to our knowledge, that's ever been undertaken in nursing itself. And there were four different bits to this, just to give you the kind of schematic overview. There was a survey of nurses themselves who were working in practice. We only looked at nurses working in general medical and surgical units, so this did not include specialist areas, which often are better staffed in many ways. So probably some of the most hard-pressed areas in an acute hospital. We also looked at patient satisfaction data. In fact, we published an article last week in BMJ on matching this data with patient satisfaction. We looked at the routinely collected administrative data around patient death rates, and also corrected for the effects of different types of hospitals and their characteristics. So we controlled for as many of the different variables that might impact on biasing our study as possible. This just gives you a flavour of the numbers of different units and hospitals that were included in what was a representative random sample across the UK, certainly, and in other countries. These were the things that we were interested in nurses' views on. So the overall staffing numbers, how many patients they were looking after on their last shift. So it was very much a kind of cross-sectional census view, one moment and point in time. The quality of the practice environment, which is really, as we know from previous research and schools, a lot of research being done in schools to know the enabling factors that make for better patient and student outcomes, at least in a lot of read over from research and education to how this works out through in the healthcare setting as well. Quality of care indicators derive from these administrative data sets and also outcomes such as burnout, emotional exhaustion, things we know impact on nurses' capacity in a sustained way to stay in the workforce and indeed to deliver high quality care. I'm just going to skip over that previous slide simply to say that there's a lot of research in this area, and a major review in 2007 confirmed that there was a significant relationship between nurse staffing and patient outcomes. This study here in 2007 too is the first one to demonstrate in Europe that that relationship also prevailed, because most of the research had come from the US, and the criticism often was levelled at this type of research that, well, it's all very well for North America, but it's not relevant here because the context is very different. And it made it very easy for policymakers to brush aside some of these findings. So what we see here is a kind of just a status report, at least a kind of taking the pulse of the profession as to where England features in this rank order of challenges that are actually wrought by the environmental conditions under which nurses are actually having to work. And what we see here essentially is that nurses are amongst the most burnt out in Europe, highest levels of stress and burnout and emotional exhaustion. So that's, I think, the first thing to note. And our levels are as high as some of the countries which have been hardest hit by the austerity measures. This slide, I think, summarises some of that. It demonstrates where we are in terms of a number of different metrics. So we are seventh in terms of poverty, if you like, of performance in terms of staffing and resource adequacy. So low down that pecking order. We're one of the worst in Europe for skill mix. That means the ratio of registered nurses to healthcare support workers. So one of the most dilute workforces in terms of the registered nurse, which is the baseline qualification for a nurse. We are third from the bottom in terms of the numbers of graduates in our workforce. So although there's been a lot made of nurses moving into the university and critics retaliating and saying that all the problems of nursing today, it's all because of the universities. And that's how nurses have somehow, their brains have displaced their capacity to care with all this knowledge, this theoretical nonsense. And so we argue, of course, that, well, if higher education is such a negative force for evil in the world, you would expect the concentration of nurses with bachelor's degrees and being graduates to be much higher in the workforce. Instead, we're not high performing, we are low performing. We are not the leaders in Europe, we are the laggards in Europe. Similarly, poor quality of work environment, and as I mentioned, the nurse burnout levels are really alarming. And that converts into high levels of intent to leave. So turnover and churn in the workforce. We know that good quality care, one of the underpinning forces is stability of leadership over time. Many of the high-performing hospitals have got chief executives and a leadership team that endures for decades. It's not the shelf life of a chief executive these days. The average is 2.5 years, which is similar lifespan to a football manager, I am told. So the more churn you create in organisations, the more unlikely you are to be able to sustain consistency and quality. Nurses reporting too few staff to deliver high quality care. Nurses come into the profession, we want to do a good job. That makes us feel satisfied and rewarded. When those resources are not there, it is deeply dissatisfying. Not only that, though, it creates a sense of moral distress. We have amongst the lowest, some of the highest nurse-to-patient ratios in Europe as well. That means the workload is in the upper quartile compared to our European colleagues. So we have very high workloads, high burnout rates, low skill concentration, and a capacity to mobilise often more support personnel but not more registered workers. The reports on the work environment suggest cause for concern here. High levels of our environments are regarded as being only poor or fair. This is an interesting one. It links back to the point made about mid-Staffordshire. A lack of confidence in management to resolve issues. So one of the issues around mid-staffs was when problems and failures were raised with management, there was a lack of responsiveness to do anything about it, or it was blindsided, or criticism was stamped on and shut down. We also know from research in the safety world that actually being able to raise these issues and question authority, it's absolutely front and centre in enacting or mobilising a response to quality concerns. That is so fundamental, and that's what the airline industry have done extremely well, which is held up as an exemplar of good practice often. And this is not just an issue that's relevant to nurses. It impacts, of course, massively on patients. And what we see here is a very close alignment between what nurses value about quality of their work environments and what patients actually want as well. There's an alignment between these types of reports from nurses and patient satisfaction. Patient satisfaction is a major metric that policymakers use in order to evaluate the robustness and, if you like, the quality of the health system itself and its responsiveness to human concerns in care. And just to reinforce the point, each of these dots represents one hospital. What we see happening here is a clustering again of safety and the work environments. So the quality of a work environment is an important predictor of the safety grade and level of that hospital. Similarly, it maps on very tightly and closely onto work environments and nurse burnout. So the quality of a practice environment has a capacity to protect nurses against burnout. So basically what we see are large variations across Europe in terms of many of the inputs and the outputs in care. But these are not just numbers, these are actually human, part of the human impact of the variations in staffing itself. And we've got to ask ourselves, to what extent are these variations acceptable or not? And are they the products of strong, sound planning mechanisms, or are they just the random effects of poor management? So that's one of the questions we were trying to tackle. I think just because I also come from an education background, and this notion that over many years we've been trying to promote better education for nurses, and in 2013 the policy was promoted to establish graduate entry as the baseline qualification for nurses. Years and decades after many other groups had fought for that right itself. And actually, I think this is an important slide because it demonstrates that actually the concentration of nurses in our workforce is lamentably low. 28% of our survey had degrees. Just to demonstrate and drive home the point about the impact of staffing on patient outcomes and mortality rates, basically the higher you go up that scale, that means the larger the number of patients that are being allocated to nurses. So the higher the workload, the poorer the higher the mortality for patients. What we see is the reverse trend with education, that the better educated the nurses, so the greater the capacity to mobilise knowledge, the better the outcomes for patients. That just demonstrates that within our hospitals, each of those spikes represents one hospital, that there's huge variation even within the same units across our hospitals in the National Health Service. I think this is an interesting slide with respect to our current concerns here today, because it moves from looking at, if you like, the dose of nurses in the workforce, how the numbers of nurses, to how nurses are actually deployed, which is also extremely important through skill mix and other mechanisms, to finally what they're able to do at the front line. And we asked nurses in our survey not only what they were able to do, but what they actually had to omit from care. And we've written and published papers on this. And you will notice that one of the most frequently omitted items of care is comfort talk with patients. So when the pressure is on and the compassion squeeze, if you like, is at its height, comfort talk is the thing that's most frequently missed when nurses are having to prioritise some of these other factors, which essentially are serving the patient pathway, medications, pain relief, attending to treatments, all the things that have to be legally signed for and for which the nurse is accountable. Those all get done, the bureaucratic exercises, not simply bureaucratic, because obviously pain relief is an important part of servicing and responding to the human cry for help. But small wonder, we argue, that the public see nurses as lacking in compassion when comfort talk and educating patients about their discharge post-hospital are actually missed from care. So it gives the public the impression that nurses are lacking in compassion, but it's just that without time as a resource to allocate in the way in which nurses would like to allocate it to patient care, without being able to prioritise in that way, you've got to make a decision, which is a risk management decision, a system of care that somewhat favours what can I afford to leave out when I have all these other competing priorities. That just, again, says the same thing in a slightly different way, is the number of items increases with the weaker staff numbers and mix. So we published an article in The Lancet last year that elaborated on this point, and we started to model the numbers of lives that could be saved by improving the numbers of the stock, if you like, of the staffing levels and the richness of the skill mix. So we estimated that if you set your benchmark at 60% bachelor's nurses and moderated the workload so it was less than a patient ratio of 1 in 8, you could reduce deaths across European hospitals by 3,500 per year. So nurses do save lives. Our data is the first to demonstrate this. And just to finish, really, thinking, why is it that there's been a media backlash against nurses? Well, we argue that nurses are not intrinsically in caring. They haven't lost their intrinsic capacity to care, but they've been working under conditions which make it very, very difficult to give expression to that capacity to care. And there are very good reasons, which I hope you will have been convinced by, from our data, why that has happened. Nurses are not actually being enabled to deliver the care that they really want to deliver and serve the best interests of patients. And there's a health consequence of that for nurses themselves, which I think is a longer term, more and as worrying a trend. There are things that we can do, though. There are levers in the system. Yes, we can improve staffing levels. We can improve the quality of the practice work environments by doing so, by improving the education of nurses, by setting certain standards and benchmarks in staffing numbers. I think we would go, having a safe staffing, a proper safe staffing policy, scientifically worked out, we could do that. Wales has just passed legislation on this very issue. We can talk about the policy pirouetting and interference around that policy in England, if any of you are interested. That we can start to stabilise and reduce the variation, the unwarranted variation in staffing numbers across the service. Bevan, when he launched the National Health Service, said that the ambition of the service should be universalising the best, making that accessible to all in the British population, regardless of ability to pay. We're still somewhere short of that, and we're probably shortest of that in nursing. We don't see the same variation in medical numbers. The greatest single input of variability, I would argue, in producing quality of care in our country is nursing. That's at the heart of the compassion debate in Britain today. Thank you very much for listening.